Hi everyone, Jay Van Gorten here with FCP Euro, and today we're going to talk about the third generation of the EA888 TSI engine. We're going to talk about some of the problems you can expect, whether you're looking to buy one of these cars or if you're already a current owner. Let's get started. We're going to get started with some of the common oil leaks that you can find on these engines. So the first thing we're going to talk about here is the cam bridge. This is found on the passenger side of the engine. And basically, what you're going to see is a lot of oil leaks coming from these seals on the inside. So this is where your cam adjuster magnet sits. And basically, this seal here holds in all the oil. So commonly, these will leak and you'll get any type of like, you'll get like an external oil leak coming out of the cam adjusters. And then eventually, down into the cam cover, or the upper timing cover, I should say. Important thing to note on the cam bridge here is, compared to the Gen 1 engines, the Gen 1 had a really notorious problem with, there was an oil screen here that became dislodged. In some cases, it would actually travel over to the other side of the cylinder head and starve the cylinder head of oil. The newer style, the Gen 3 engines, don't have that little screen anymore, so it's one less thing you have to worry about. But you still do see the seals leaking on front here. Which brings me to my next component is the upper timing cover. You're gonna see leaks in a couple different places around these seals here. Also on the perimeter here, there's a gasket. Good thing about the gasket is you don't have to buy the entire cover. You can service this gasket separately. Just make sure you replace it with a good high quality OE or OEM seal. Stay away from the aftermarket stuff on a lot of the components on this engine. Another thing is if you're going to replace this cover, same thing, make sure you stay away from aftermarket. I've seen a lot of these aftermarkets actually warp straight out of the box. So a lot of people, they spend the time and the labor to put these components or the upper cover on the engine and it just leaks straight away. So stick with OE, OEM. I can't mention the upper cover without the lower cover. So this is the lower timing chain cover. It mates against the block. Unlike the upper cover, this cover is not held in by a rubber gasket, but instead it uses a silicone sealant. This cover is necessary when you're replacing any of the timing components, whether you're changing out your timing chain or switching out the tensioner. You can reuse this, but I'm gonna highly advise that you don't. And the reason why is because this is silicone in, like especially the factory Volkswagen sealant is really, really tough to get in there. And a lot of times you're literally jamming screwdrivers in there just to kind of bend and pry this thing out of place. So as a precaution, I highly recommend it. If you're replacing your timing chain or any of the components there, for any reason you have to take this off, replace it with a brand new one. Speaking of oil leaks, so this is the upper PCV valve. And you may notice I have two here in front of me because I want to show you the difference. One of these is from the Gen 1 engines and the second one is from the Gen 2. So one of the major updates of this engine was the PCV system. The Gen 1 had a few different components, and on the Gen 3s, the engineers really tried to simplify the PCV system, and a lot of the components were actually built inside the cylinder head. But one of the main components on the actual PCV valve that is different and made a huge difference in these engines is this right here. It's the cyclone. So this is the Gen 1 PCV valve, and you're going to notice that this cyclone is kind of pitched on an angle. And on the Gen 3, the newer ones, you're going to see it's more of a straight vertical design. And this made a huge difference with a lot of the carbon buildup on the back of the valves, believe it or not. So more oil was actually drained down into the block and stayed out of the intake stream. And over time, that prolonged a lot of the carbon cleaning services that you saw on these engines. Now, I'm not saying that you're not going to have to, clean the backs of the valves, because that is still a problem. But this primarily actually helped out a lot with that drastically. If you're looking for more information on carbon cleaning, what it takes to do that job, we actually have a really good video that shows you exactly what's entailed. Check out the link above. The next component I want to talk about is actually the rear main seal. While this is a very inexpensive part, it is pretty critical. This is found behind the transmission, so if you're looking to swap out your rear main seal if it's leaking, which is very, very common on these cars, especially with this design, you will have to drop the transmission. But with that said, we actually do have a really good upgrade. This is the AYA bed rear main seal. And basically it swaps over and changes the design of the seal itself to a more traditional press-in style. Not only that, but the seal is actually serviceable, so you don't have to replace the entire housing every single time. The iBed unit does come as a complete kit, so it's basically the entire housing. It comes with new bolts and a new OE seal. And the last major component is the oil pan. So while these don't leak a ton, you do see some leaks on these, but I want to talk about this primarily because they're made of plastic. For a lot of you guys out there who are looking for GTIs or Jettas, a lot of you guys will lower these cars. This is actually one of the biggest weak points on these cars. Because this unit is plastic, it is very brittle, and if you hit any type of debris in the road, chances are that it's gonna crack the pan. If you do happen to hit anything in the road, always be alert of any type of lights that are on your dash, like the oil pressure light. And if you do hit something and you see that light come on your dash, make sure you shut the car off immediately and pull over to the side of the road. Do not restart it. You can replace the pan. It does come with a gasket, but a lot of people will actually look to upgrade this unit and they'll go back in time and use the oil pan from the Gen 1 engines, which is stamped steel. Another reason why I mentioned that is while you don't see too many leaks from this and this particular gasket and this pan, when you swap over to the stamped steel, if you don't really, really clean the mating surface really well, when you're bolting that in and after it's been in the car for a while, you will see a lot of oil leaking from the gasket on that pan. One of the other solutions that you can do to avoid smashing the oil pan in these cars is to not only replace it with the stamped steel oil pan, but you can also get an aftermarket skid plate. We have a few different options on the website, whether aluminum or some of the factory upgrades, such as the Alltrek skid plate, which is made of Kevlar. All right, so that about wraps it up for oil leaks. Oil leaks are not limited to the components I have in this table, but I think I covered a lot of the major components that leak on these engines. So with that said, let's move on to the cooling section, and I'll talk about some of the issues you can expect there. So the first thing we're gonna talk about is the water pump assembly. It houses not only just the water pump, which is seen on the side here, but also has the electronically controlled rotary slide valve that are built into this entire assembly. Now, this assembly leaks in a few different ways. Number one, it's plastic. So the hot and cold cycles is gonna get brittle over time and you may start to see some cracks. So that's something to expect and keep an eye on over time. The second thing is the seals that mount to the engine side. Now, these seals, over time, they will degrade and they will start to leak a little bit, but you also have something else working against it. Any type of oil leak that's coming from the top of the engine, whether it's from the camshaft side or the top of the engine on the valve cover side, any type of oil that's coming down can also seep into this plastic part between, you know, the seam between the engine and this, and get at these seals and just, you know, they'll swell them up and degrade them. So that's another pain point. The last pain point I want to talk about is on the water pump side. So there is a seal. This is the separated water pump here. So there's a gasket that rides in this groove here. It mates just like this. That seal can go bad as well. So that's another thing to look out for. My personal preference, you know, if you're leaking at the water pump and, you know, it's not too much money to swing it, I would just recommend that you replace the entire unit as an assembly. Last thing to talk about on a water pump is obviously the belt. This belt is what drives the water pump. Now keep in mind, this is mounted underneath the intake manifold. So you have to remove the intake manifold to get to it. And it's driven off the balance shaft by means of this small belt. So a lot of times, most people will reuse this belt. We don't see too many problems with these things like snapping or breaking or degrading too much over time. So a lot of people will reuse these. If you want to swap it out, you can. However, there are special tools that are required. Basically, it's really hard to get this bolt out. If you can get those tools and you want to spend the extra money, feel free. That's probably the proper way to do it. But real world scenario, most people and even most dealerships that I know of are actually just, you know, they're taking, they're sliding this belt off with a pick and they're reusing the belt. If you're interested in changing out the water pump or the water pump assembly, be sure to check out the link above. We actually did a really good DIY that shows you everything that's entailed in that procedure and that job. Now we've gone over the water pump assembly. Now keep in mind, still keep an eye out for all the traditional, you know, your coolant hoses to check out. Check out your radiator, make sure that's not leaking. You know, just always be mindful of other coolant leaks. This isn't the only thing that leaks in the system, but it is the more common component. But with that said, we're gonna move on to our next component, which is the intake manifold assembly. So the intake manifold, it has had a lot of upgrades over the time, especially from the Gen 1s. The Gen 1, they actually had a new revision sent out. And the reason for that was they were having a lot of issues with carbon buildup on the flaps, the runners. Also, there's a linkage on the side here. Those were breaking and falling off, giving a lot of range issue codes. So overall, the design was really, really improved. And that carried over to the Gen 3 engines. And you didn't really see a ton of problems, but with that said, you still see a lot of carbon buildup on these flaps. And now that these engines are getting a little bit older in time and get more miles on them, we are starting to see a lot of the internal linkages here. If you look through this little window on the side here, you'll see there's, you still have that plastic linkage, and those are breaking over time as well. So just something to be mindful of. You know, they don't fail nearly as much as they did on the Gen 1 engines, but you know, it still could be a problem for you. Another cool feature about this intake manifold is if you look on the top here, it actually does have the casting for the multi-port injectors. So like I said, these engines are direct injected, so the fuel is squirted directly into the combustion chamber. But in Europe, these were actually multi-port as well. And there actually is a kit from APR to actually add multi-port injection to these intake manifolds. And if that is something that you're interested in doing, like I said, those castings are built into the manifold. So is an option for you. I know I just talked about some of the carbon issues on the runner flaps, how it does accumulate in here. And I know I mentioned some of the carbon buildup issues that you have on these engines before, just something else to touch on. This is a tool you're gonna need if a carbon cleaning service is something that you'll need to do on the engine. This particular component is from 034 Motorsports, and this will actually go over the port. So if you see, it's pretty much the same size as the port that goes into the cylinder head. So one side has an opening for a vacuum cleaner, so you hook up a vacuum suction to one side, and the other side has the opening for the walnut blaster. So you could literally stick in a wand and blast the tops of the valves, the intake valves, while you're sucking out with a vacuum cleaner. If a carbon cleaning service is something that you think you may run into or something that you need, this tool's a must. I definitely recommend that you buy this tool. It's pretty inexpensive. Now, along with this 034 Motorsport tool, we also do offer a complete kit that includes the actual pressurized tank, the air tank, the wand that will insert into this tool, and also walnut shells as well. If you're interested in that kit, be sure to check out the link below. So now we're done with cooling and the intake manifold setup. We're gonna move on to the timing components and some of the other smaller components that you can expect to replace along the journey of ownership. All right, so we touched on the upper and the lower timing cover earlier. One other thing I wanna add with the timing cover, I mentioned that I always recommend to replace the timing cover. Always replace the hardware, the screws that secure it to the block as well. That's a must. Those are one-time use screws, so always replace those. In addition to the timing covers, obviously behind those covers are the main components, like your timing chain. The timing chains are a wear item on these cars. I mean, so the FSI engines were belt driven, but ever since the introduction of the TSI family, the EA888 engines, they are all timing chain driven. And over time, these chains actually do stretch. So there's a couple ways to check on the stretching of the chain. Volkswagen actually does have a specification where you can count the amount of teeth between certain teeth on the gears. That's more engine specific, but more commonly so, if you do get a lot of stretch on the chain, you're also gonna get cam correlation codes, you know, as a DTC in the engine. A third way is you can actually check for the stretch through a scan tool such as, you know, VagCom. While you're replacing the chain, very obvious, you're gonna wanna replace all the guides, all brand new hardware. Everything's gotta be completely fresh. In addition to all new components for your timing chain setup, you're gonna need some special tools. What I have here, this is a counter hold for the crankshaft pulley. Now, to take the pulley off, you're gonna need the counter hold to hold it in place while you crack the screw loose. While the screw is loose, to remove the pulley, you're also gonna need this tool here. So this is a tool specifically designed to remove the crankshaft pulley. Now, where this installs is actually over the cover, like so. So you're gonna have to remove a couple screws, one here, install this, and this will enable you to remove the crankshaft pulley nice and evenly from the cover. Once the crank pulley is removed, there's this little donut here that secures onto the crankshaft to hold the rest of the timing components in place while you go about removing the other components to service and replace the timing chain system. On the top of the engine, you also have, so we talked about the cam bridge up top earlier. Inside the cam bridge, there's these seals that leak, but there's the spool valve. And the spool valve requires a special tool. So here's a set from CTA. It has three different variations of the tool. Different engines will take different tools. There's one other variation to this as well. But basically you're gonna take one of these. If you see here, there's two different dimples on the spool valve. So this tool will insert into those dimples and allow you to remove it. Just a quick note, these are reverse thread. So if it's not coming out on you, that's why. Just something to look out for. One other thing to talk about on the cam bridge. So the Gen 1 engines, you had variable valve timing on the intake side only. Now most of your Gen 3 engines, the 2 liters, are gonna come with variable valve timing on the intake and the exhaust side. Unless it's a 1.8 turbo, that's gonna come on the intake only, or if it's some of the earlier variants of the Gen 3, like the CPPA or CPLA found in the Mk6 GLI or the Beetles, that's gonna come with variable valve timing on the intake side only. All right, so with that said, we talked about the timing chain setup, we talked about the cam bridge setup. Just a quick note, it doesn't go without saying, like, changing the oil on these cars is vital. You wanna make sure you're keeping up on your oil change regularly. Just look at this spool valve, for example. These are all simple oil ports and oil screens. You know, if you develop any type of sludge in these engines, they are very, very sensitive to it. So you wanna keep clean, fresh oil in these engines at all time. You know, I recommend every 5,000 miles or less. With a good high quality synthetic oil. If you're wondering what type of oil to put in your car, there are a few different variations depending on the years of these engines. Some take 530, 540, others moved on to 020, a thinner oil. If you're not sure which oil it takes, you could either check out fcpeuro.com and visit our website and go through our catalog, or you could visit the Gen 3 Owner's Hub, where we have all the common specs and technical information there listed as well. Now moving on to some of the simpler items to replace. Very common engine mounts. So over time, as you know or may know, these are made primarily of rubber and in some cases are fluid filled. So over time, the rubber does degrade, it does sag, and you will get more movement throughout the drivetrain, especially when you're shifting through gears. So as these cars age, not a bad thing to inspect your engine mounts. You could check it out for cracks, any type of leaking, you know, if they're fluid filled. These particular mounts are gonna be found on the left and the right of the engine. So you're gonna have one on the passenger side, just in front of the timing cover. In fact, to get to the timing components, you're gonna have to support the engine and remove these mounts. The other side is gonna be on the transmission side or the driver side. Right up top, you'll have to remove the airbox to get to it. One other thing to note about the engine mounts is whenever you replace an engine mount, be sure to swap it out with brand new hardware. The bolts that are used on these engine mounts are one-time use only, so always be sure to get some new hardware and install these. Very commonly on these cars is also the dog bone mount. And we have some inserts that are very common. A lot of people, instead of replacing the entire mount, they'll actually throw inserts like this from 034 Motorsport, and that'll stiffen up the rubber mount. Basically what it does is it fills in the voids and prevents a lot of the movement coming from that particular mount. Last but not least, we're gonna go on to the ignition coils. So here we have two different coils. The black one here is the original. This is what you're gonna find in your car from the factory. And here's another aftermarket upgrade from APR. Obviously you could tell they're the red top, and this is a little bit of an aftermarket upgrade. Plus it gives your car a little bit more of a aesthetic feature. For the Gen 3 engine, these ignition coils actually were upgraded. So one of the common issues that we had with some of the coil packs in the past, especially with Volkswagen, are that they popped up over time. These are actually bolted into place. Completely new design for the Gen 3 engines, and they do fail from time to time. One other thing I want to mention, that there is a special tool that you can use to remove these. These are very difficult to remove. So basically, you could use this tool to help aid in removing. So basically, you just thread into the hole where the bolt was, you tighten it up, and then you could use this tool to pull up on the actual coil. Another quick tip, if you're going to replace your ignition coils, I suggest that you warm the engine up. It seems to be that once you warm up the engine, this rubber is a lot easier to remove from the engine. All right, guys, I hope you learned a lot and liked this video. If you did like this video, don't forget to hit that like button. If you'd like to drop any comments or add anything to this video for everyone else, be sure to comment in the box below. And also, don't forget to subscribe for more videos like this in the future. Thank you.